In this module, we'll take a look at just how actin and myosin interactions depend on ATP hydrolysis. So what you're being reminded of in this illustration is the sarcomere that shortens from the relaxed state to the contracted state. We know the structure of actin. It is a double helically wound filament of actin monomers. Let's look at myosin. Here we have a single myosin filament flanked by two actin filaments attached to their Z-line. Again, we're just cartooning things for convenience now. Your textbook shows what myosin looks like at much higher power, and this is again a cartoon interpretation of electron microscopy. Myosin filaments have a bare region in the middle, and then they are, we would say, bipolar. This is a myosin 2 filament, by the way. There are other forms of myosin used in other cells. This is what myosin looks like in a skeletal muscle cell. There's a bare region, and then projecting in both directions from that bare region are myosin monomers with their heads projecting away from or out of the filament itself. The myosin thick filament is a polymer of many myosin monomers. Each myosin monomer has two heads, the two structures at the left in this illustration. And now we can see what a myosin monomer looks like in the electron microscope after it has been isolated and dissociated from myosin thick filaments. So we recognize heads and a tail segment. We can dissect the myosin monomer into parts. We can separate the heads and tails, and we can do this using specific proteolytic enzymes. Now remember that myosin thick filaments are made of proteins, and each myosin monomer is made of two separate proteins. And they are subject to proteolysis, that is, hydrolysis by enzymes that can catalyze the hydrolysis water addition across peptide bonds. And there are some proteolytic enzymes that will catalyze hydrolysis quite specifically between particular amino acids. And when some of these are used, you can generate fragments of the myosin monomer. And here are two fragments that one might generate. One that consists primarily just of the head region, with the two heads still attached to one another, or wound around one another, and the tail region. And that would be these regions in this illustration here. The EM pictures are not actually showing chopped up myosin monomers. I have chopped them up to show you the region that they represent based on the picture at the upper part of this slide. The head region is called the S1 fraction. In an effort to understand the interaction of myosin thick filaments with actin, the thin filaments, investigators took these chopped up myosin monomers and asked whether either of the two components would bind to actin. So we can take the thick filament here, we can dissociate them into their myosin monomers, and we can add them to actin on the Z-lines, and the image of the Z-line changes in the electron microscope after the addition of these myosin monomers. Remarkably, the appearance of these decorated actin filaments was that of arrowheads, which was very neat because it suggested that the actin projects from a Z-line shown here in opposite directions. Remember that actin is a polar filament. It has a plus and a minus end, so it assembles at one end and disassembles at the other. It has a structurally a different look if you were to look at one end versus the other. And the ability to decorate actin with these myosin monomers and show these arrowheads emphasizes this polarity. And if you think about it for a moment, you'll realize that it's eminently reasonable that the actins should face in opposite direction on opposite sides of a Z-line, given how they are to interact with the intact myosin filament in a sarcomere. So what you can conclude from this is that the myosin monomer, in fact, really it's just the S1 head that has this ability to bind to actin. It binds to actin whether free or on Z-lines. We say the actin was decorated either by intact myosin monomers or by just the heads. I don't have a picture of decoration of actin in skeletal muscle, but I do have a picture of actin that shows this arrowhead appearance in the microvilli of the cells lining the small intestine. While the waves of food being pushed through the small intestine help the microvilli to stay apart from one another, right, not come glued together, and enhance absorption, the microvilli have these bundles of actin which interact with other proteins in the cell and actually are capable of independent movement. The point of the slide is to show you the decoration of actin in. And so you can see all the arrowheads are pointing into intestinal cell from the microvilli where the backs of the arrows are. What can we say so far from this module and another module, the previous one? Well, actin and myosin do bind, and specifically the myosin head is responsible for binding to actin. We can say that ATP is hydrolyzed during contraction, that is when filaments are allowed to slide. And we can say that the myosin heads are a kind of cross bridge, and that's the terminology we use, a cross bridge between the long axis of the myosin or thick filament and the actin thin filaments. Okay, knowing that muscle contraction in any event is going to require free energy, studies of purified actin and myosin soon revealed a few things, and these are that the myosin thick filaments were capable of binding ATP and would actually hydrolyze ATP, although very slowly. Actin, on the other hand, had no such ATP hydrolyzing activity. So it looked like the myosin would be the site of ATP hydrolysis that would power contraction. The S1 fraction of the myosin monomer, the myosin heads, were the site of the ATP binding and hydrolysis. The S1 fraction was the only component of myosin that would hydrolyze ATP. And again, it was slow hydrolysis. To review then, these myosin monomers are slow ATPases catalyzing ATP hydrolysis, and the activity in the head, if you do this experiment with the tail, you don't get any activity. In this illustration, we imagine that the myosin heads, which are the cross bridges to actin, must bind and unbind, and they actually must, in effect, walk along actin in order that the actin be drawn sliding along the myosin filament. So we have a cartoon here with a bit of actin and a chunk of myosin and a green head. And what we imagine must happen is that the myosin undergoes several stages in a cycle of conformational change that pulls the actin along. So let's see if this diagram makes any sense. So we just saw that a myosin head bound to actin became unbound. That same myosin head just shifted in position, changed in shape, changed its conformation, and in its new conformation, it could bind actin again, but this time it bound an actin monomer further along the actin filament. And in final animation, the actin is drawn along the myosin because the myosin head changes conformation once more to the shape and conformation or angle, if you like, that we started with. So let's look at this one more time. You imagine that every myosin head is doing this to actin, and it's not doing it in a synchronized fashion, it's doing this asynchronously. You can imagine lots of little myosin heads alternately grabbing onto actin, drawing it forward a little bit, letting go, and then quickly flipping back and grabbing actin in another position in order to make the actin filament slide towards the center, basically, of the myosin thick filament. Now, does this really happen? Yes, we have evidence that it does. This is a form of myosin in which one can actually study in the electron microscope or capture in the electron microscope the myosin head in different conformations. So what you imagine here is that many electron micrographs were taken of myosin heads in various stages of conformation, and then the illustrations were organized in an order that made sense. Just to look at that head, it has at least five different conformations. It sits at five different angles, relatively speaking, to the myosin thick filament, which is shown horizontally at the bottom of each image. With that information in hand, we can model, or that is to say, try to explain how ATP fuels contraction, that is the sliding of actin along the myosin thick filament, and how it then also seems to function in relaxation, namely to separate actin and myosin. In other words, we're going to try and resolve this paradox. So at the top of this picture, we imagine that there's thick filament shown in green and a single myosin head projected, shown projecting upwards, and of course the actin on top. The ATP is bound to the myosin head. When the ATP is hydrolyzed, take a look at the myosin head. It's changed shape from a conformation 1 to a conformation 2, that's C1 to C2. So now one of the phosphates has come off, but there's still ADP and it's still bound to this myosin head. I have placed a little black dot in one of the actin monomers so that we can follow any changes in the spatial relationship between that myosin head and actin. I put a little white dot directly below in the myosin. We'll look at the white dot and the black dot relative to one another to see whether things have moved or not. So we have conformation 2 now. In that conformation, with ADP bound to the head, actin and myosin have an affinity for one another and they bind, as shown. The next step is what's called the power stroke of contraction at the level of myosin-actin interaction. The myosin, having bound to the actin, changes shape, changes conformation, changes its angle, and pulls the F-actin, the filament actin, towards the left. And the inorganic phosphate in the process comes off of the myosin head. And you see at the bottom of the illustration, ADP bound to the myosin head, and the myosin head still bound to actin. And now if you look at the black dot and the white dot, you can see that the black dot has indeed shifted to the left relative to the white dot, indicating that, in fact, actin has slid relative to myosin. In the next step, the ADP comes off. Why does it come off? Because when the head binds to the actin in this illustration, where the myosin is back in its C1 conformation, that binding alters the conformation ever so slightly so that the ADP no longer wants to stick, and so it comes off. Now you're looking at the far left of this cycle at the equivalent of rigor. The ADP has been hydrolyzed. The ATP in a person who has passed away, he eventually gets used up. And what you're left with is myosin heads bound to actin permanently. That's rigor mortis. In a living individual, in a living muscle, rigor does not persist. If there's ATP around, it can bind to the myosin head. And binding of ATP to the myosin head changes the conformation, again, just enough, so that the myosin head becomes dissociated from the actin. So in a living muscle, in the relaxed state, ATP is always going to be associated with the myosin head before the next contraction. Think about that for a bit. So this is the cycle of making and breaking myosin cross bridges and explains the role of ATP in both contraction and relaxation. So the paradox is resolved. That brings us to the end of this module. There is another module which deals with the regulation of muscle contraction.